I'm so excited to be here, and I guess to kind of have my performance chops, I will have a costume change. So glad to be here. I'm going to start with this video and then I'll just say a few little things. This is like 2.5 minutes, it's not very long. I'll probably talk for about 15 or 20 minutes, show some work. Both of them and I will have a conversation, we'll have some questions. Totally chill. So, let's just start this.
Whether you're a novice or an expert, the National Rose Garden welcomes you as we consider the American landscape. We hope you'll visit us and see what's in bloom. For more information, go to our website at www.nationalrosegarden.com. To receive a complimentary brochure with stunning photographs and featured roses, email us at info@nationalrosegarden.com. And for that special gift, visit our shop for stationery, commemorative china, and more. We look forward to welcoming you at the National Rose Garden.
So I want to start off by thanking Sandra Ruiz, Gilberto Rosas, in the Latino Studies program here at the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign. It's a real honor to be here among fellow artists and thinkers. One of my favorite things I've heard Santo state is a clear acknowledgement that our ideas are not our own. My work is indebted to many other artists, researchers, friends, and family, and I hope you do justice to what I so love about each of those relationships. I'd like to talk today about subjectivity and the institutions that produce it. We each live within a context comprised of systems and codes. Let's call these codes institutions. These institutions, they inform our subjectivity through repetitive actions, engagements, and estrangements. I'm interested in the ways that these systems are performed on us, the ways we internalize these systems, re-perform them in our landscapes, and ultimately, how we build conversation to resist, co-opt, or work within them. So it's actually, I'm gonna just interject myself here. just to explain what's going on, there's a lot of like digital alteration in the photographs that's happening. So, for example, here, this is a photograph at the National Portrait Gallery in DC. And so I just digitally altered the text of the display setting so that it calls itself Conquest. And that's the category we're looking at. So just keep your eyes peeled. So when working in social critique, it is important to identify when topics feel actionable, meaning there is a general agreement on what the issue is, and an understanding of what is at stake, and what endpoints are to be achieved. This is often the realm of social practice, producing measurable results and engagements within a fixed community to produce change. However, there are many conversations that are not yet actionable, meaning they require continued dialogue, involvement, examination, and lack a clear sense of what, if anything, is to be done. This is where I situate my work in the affective and emotive spaces where institutions and personal experience reveal themselves as connected. In order to do this, I often work within several constraints. See, I'll just read that. It says opportunity, cost, desire, speculation. One is to minimize confrontation. Using subtlety, nuance, and familiar forms, I examine ways to alter the fixed environment and make its unseen dynamics visible. By working with no clearly prescribed mode of reception, engagement at any scale is possible, and not measured against the artist's intent or the perceptions of others. A further tactic is to quote the language of system building itself, the largely academic and removed voice that talks about us and measures us, but is not us. Terms such as excess labor and human capital are not the ways we speak of ourselves, but the ways in which our position and value in the social structure are measured by others. By placing these phrases in direct association with experience, I hope to invoke the process by which ideologies become actions and affect, informed subjectivities. In relating these ideas to the symposium's theme, being down, being brown, I'd like to bring in the ways that these institutions are performed on bodies of color, queerness, and difference. That reads, monetize, colonize, expand. So, just a little aside from the prepared thing. I'm normally really not personal with my work. There's this kind of strategy of almost cleansing myself in a lot of ways from the work that I do, so that was very integral. So I decided to blow that out of the water and go really personal with something that I recently found. So my family immigrated to the United States from Chile in 1972. It says displacement. During the hollowing of Allende socialism, just before the 1973 coup that brought Pinochet to power and placed Chile in a dictatorship until 1990. An estimated 35,000 people were tortured, executed, or disappeared, including two members of my grandmother's family. Roughly 200,000 people suffered in exile. They knew a small handful of relatives in Connecticut and moved there with tourist visas, good for several weeks. That's them. Not speaking the language, my grandfather began working three jobs to support his wife and their six children. He was reported within the year as being undocumented. Rather than face deportation into a dictatorship, they fled overnight to Miami, where they continue to live today, all of mixed legal status. My grandfather died in 2011. In 1991, he sat down to write this letter to his family while my grandmother was away. So, that's my grandfather. I'm gonna read a bit of his letter. Feel free to kind of just like laugh, do whatever you want. It's not, you know,
stretch.
It's all cool. and there's parts of it that I don't agree with myself, so I'm just using his voice. February 4th, 1991. For Nancy and the whole family, wife, mother, number one grandma, my loving and adoring wife, in these moments of time and distance, it makes me feel and think how much I love you, and how much I have been a fool in my ways. With shouts and bad manners, my temper for 30 years, forgive me. I've never been romantic, and this will not happen anymore. I was looking at the photo albums. I thank you for having given me 6 children, of which I am very proud to see them grown up with families. This is only possible with your great effort, love, and sacrifice. It is repeated again with our grandchildren. I'm just going to take a second to totally show them. There we go. Okay, now it's crisp. All right. Sorry, back into the mood. All right. If one day you are all together, I will tell you all, give thanks to your mother, that you are now educated with decent jobs. Our economic situation has never been good. If not for your mother who always worried about your studies, going to your schools, and speaking with your teachers. If not for this, all of you would have been working in factories. I'm not asking for help, thank God we do not need it. Having work, there are no problems. Note, if one day I do not have work because of layoffs, I will get paid unemployment. Some months in the meantime, I will be filling out the application for stability. But first, I need to know what benefits I will have. Medicaid, weekly checks, food stamps. I cannot accept jobs for less than what I am paid now because retirement pays a percentage of the final salary paid the last 5 years. I would lose money in the future. Nancy can retire at 65 years of age. They will give her a retirement similar to mine. Do not worry. We will never be a burden to you all. Quote, try to do note, try to do family reunions at someone's house, in a park, or like a TV show, 8 is enough. For everyone, I ask you a favor that you invite your mother to your houses for breakfast or dinner time. It's not necessary to do special things, only that attention is paid to her. I think attention, Jorge, Elizabeth, Jessica, Jacqueline, Madeline, Danny, their children. I thank you for having studied, having a good education. Everything will be much easier for you when finding your own place and for your own children. Your economic situation will be better. Try between your families to get together, big and small, to make meals and have reunions with each other, contributing their part. I have more time to be with Nancy. I feel good and hope. I feel good and more calm by her side. What I feel is that I am sick. 8 times in the hospital, 1 time each year, she suffers very much with these problems. For 8 years, her economic situation has been up and down. We all must take care of your mother and respect her much more and never leave her alone. One phone call is the solution for her to feel happy. There are people who call only when they need something. This must stop and have more respect for your mother. Try to have family reunions, everyone together having conversation, your children playing with each other. When you come to our apartment, your mother has everything ready in the kitchen. Only you should tell your mother to sit, that you will serve yourselves food and put everything on the table. After, wash the dishes and leave the kitchen clean. You all are grown. Do not treat your mother like an employee. She is tired with these many years of work. In the mornings, say good morning to your mother, and when you leave, tell us you are going to leave, that you will be back later. This is not to ask permission, but as respect for your parents. Try to do family reunions. All the brothers and sisters get together with your children, husbands and wives, so the children can play with each other. You all have seen 8 is Enough on TV. It's a good movie. Make sure each person puts in their share to make food. Jorge, you were the first to be born. You have not had the same luck as your brothers and sisters. You married very young and never listened to your parents. Now try to come or invite your mother to your house. Converse with her. You have separated yourself from the family, and this makes your mother suffer. You are not to blame for your problems. You have found them yourself. We are not going to ask for anything, don't worry. Call your mother on the phone and greet her in the morning or evening. Ask her how she is doing. This is what makes her feel happy, that her son has not forgotten her. Thank your spouses and children. All of us, Nancy, Sergio, all of us. When visiting someone, we would bring everything needed for us to eat. This was always received everywhere, very well, and we were never told the problems. All of you should respect and care much more for your mother, Nancy. There's only one mother. There's no one else in the world who can replace her. We love all of you equally, children and grandchildren, husbands and wives. We want you happy and without problems. This is good for your children. Husbands and wives should work full time in order to have better economic situations so that your children lack for nothing and to be able to serve, to have a better education in the future. This will help you avoid the familiar problems we have had and become people who have everything. You should work day and night. Both men and women should work. This is what the rich do. What is the difference between us and the rich? Have we not done the same as them? So, I'm gonna stop there with reading it. And I did skip one little part that I want to go back to only because it's important to me. At one point he says, to my uncle Jorge, he says, we want to take Cindy to the movies or anywhere else that she wants to go, but she always says she is busy and has everything scheduled for the week. I think that having some time to be with us is not asking a lot. You have taught her to be an American. You have not taught the family and children to have good manners with their elders. The grandchildren should be with their grandparents some of the time. This is part of learning and being with the family. The letter continues for three more pages, but this is the only moment, the comment about the rich and don't do the same as them. This is the only moment that my grandfather confronts being within a structure, framing us as perpetually not rich, and sensing some qualifier, making our experience different from theirs, while having no real sense of exactly what it is. For me, this is being brown and being marked as other, rules of engagement withheld, dominance reinforced, removal from competition, and a fixed position in a state of exception, and yet still finding ways to succeed. Being told you are here, but not the same way we are. Well, it seems my grandfather was encouraging his family to transcend and become the we on the other side through education and work. He also appears skeptical of it, alluding to a diminished sense of la familia and an internalization of American values he rejects, even accusing my uncle of raising my cousin to be an American. Interestingly, his way of handling our states of exception was to create one of his own, approving the economic models of being American and rejecting the social. I wonder if Jose Munoz would have considered this a kind of disidentifying. To me, reading it now is certainly a way of navigating, and one that still produces conflict for me in the attempt to be a good subject. In the eyes of my grandfather, how American should I be? When is it too much? In the eyes of this America place, how brown can I be? How queer? When is it too much? I know for sure he would want me wasting my time on this, and rather I just be happy and not burdened by obligation or worry. But how can you not? I am in a receivership position, not only of their context, but of the institutions I inherit and the traumas that went into shaping them. Power is not given or shared willingly, and the history of racial justice in this country is a horror that continues both backwards and forwards. For a long time, I thought my citizenship as a first-generation American, born here by an immigrant mother, was an entitlement, a gift written on the Statue of Liberty, testimony to the benevolence of this democratic project. Even as a kid, I knew there was some position, some equivalence my body had access to that my mother did not, merely by circumstance of my birth. I'm embarrassed to admit, but I only recently learned my citizenship is a direct result of the need for a solution to the freed slave population, a legal framework passed only 4 years after an emancipation that also set the path to one of the largest incarceration frameworks for bodies of color in the world. Quote, "Neither slavery nor involuntary servitude, except as a punishment for crime, whereof the party shall have been duly convicted, shall exist within the United States, or any place subject to their jurisdiction." Thanks to this nod to embedded power, bodies of color would be, for the next 148 years and beyond, withheld, dominated, and removed from competition, creating a racial underclass of bare and contextual citizenship. The fact is that our citizenship has been contested since 1790. In a line from the Naturalization Act of 1790, quote, "that any alien being a free white person," qualified in a line from the Naturalization Act of 1795, quote, "a free white person such that he has behaved as a man of good moral character." In the opening lines of the Chinese Exclusion Act of 1882, quote, "whereas in the opinion of the governments of the United States, the coming of Chinese laborers to this country endangers the good order of certain localities within the territory." And the admission by the Supreme Court case, United States versus Wong Kim Ark, 1898, a challenge to the aforementioned act that ultimately provided our current reading of the 14th Amendment that allows me to be considered a citizen of this country. Quote, "the Constitution of the United States, as originally adopted, uses the words citizen of the United States and natural born citizen of the United States. Yet the Constitution nowhere defines the meaning of these words. The Constitution does not, in words, say who shall be natural born citizens. Resort must be had elsewhere to ascertain that." Quote, nowhere defines the meaning of these words. Perhaps not in explicit definitions, but we are made to understand in codes, in systems, in structures, in actions that repeat themselves to this day, performing themselves on us and commanding subjectivities from us, from the stripping of funding for public education, to police brutality and intimidation, to gerrymandering, to predatory lending, to discriminatory voices allowed to hide anonymously behind chalk. I can't help but hear in all of them the same state of exception my grandfather felt, but with a slight variation. You are here, but barely. Let's remember to celebrate and support each other as we insistently shout back, we are here, have been here, and always the same way you are, if not beyond.